A lot of hard work has gone into it, but we're still a long ways to go. We're still arguably the youngest football team in all of college football.
Finish the play! Finish the play!
Our expectation is to win the SEC, win the SEC East. We always talk about the power of one, taking it one day at a time, and embracing the process as we go. We got to put in the hours and put in the work now to get what we want to succeed in the end.
It's all about the process, and we're still not anywhere where we need to be, but we're making tremendous strides each and every day.
Hello and welcome to the Tennessee Football Preview Show. I'm Maria Taylor. That is Greg McElroy, the former Alabama quarterback. And that is our rookie in the game, Jabari Greer, the former cornerback from Tennessee. We're throwing him a bone and letting him get in on his alma mater's preview show.
Yes, I'm excited. You know, just don't douse me with ice water being the rookie yet.
Okay, we're going to try. We'll see. We'll get him going early with expectations at Tennessee. And they are sky high on Rocky Top with good reason. The Volunteers won four of their last final five games, Greg. Pretty good to end the season.
Going from the hunter, the hunted, though, a little different mindset entering the 2015 season.
Well, and Butch Jones, he's been pretty masterful on the recruiting trail. The Volunteers welcomed in their second straight top five recruiting class this season, Jabari.
Yeah, bringing some of the best talent in the nation to help Rocky Top once again claim the throne.
The Volunteers will be tested early, though, when the 19th-ranked Oklahoma Sooners come to town in week two. Oklahoma knocked off Tennessee 34-10 last season.
And Oklahoma new offensive coordinator in Lincoln Riley is going to kind of surprise Tennessee with what type of offensive scheme they're going to have. Should be a great test for the Volunteers.
Well, this was the surprise of last year. Josh Dobbs, that's who. The junior enters his first season as a full-time starter after being the catalyst behind Tennessee's resurgence last season.
Yeah, he came in, played well. Now it's his time to take the reins. Let's see what this young man can do this year.
And shine away is what he will be trying to do. Josh Dobbs was extremely good under pressure last season. Dobbs completed 80% of his passes when he was blitzed last year, the best percentage of any SEC quarterback just a season ago. And Jabari, we'll start with you. So year two, Josh Dobbs is the full-time starter. What are the expectations for him coming into 2015?
Well, I think the expectation is going to be big because from the first year to the second year, your growth is so dramatic, especially as a quarterback. I think that the game starts to slow down for you. I think your first year, you just happen to be at the dance. You know, the second year, you have to be able to anticipate more than you did your first year, to have command on the offense and be able to methodically take your team down the field.
If he's able to come in and have the same type of impact he had last year, now with the defensive coordinators around this conference having six games of tape on him, they know how to attack him, they know what he does well, they know where he struggles, and if he's able to continue to elevate his play, I think he's got a real chance to become a dark horse Heisman candidate, maybe not even just this year, but maybe next year because of his athletic ability.
Okay, early expectations. Let's talk about another guy who's looking to elevate his play, Jalen Hurd, the big running back for Tennessee, averaged 69 yards per game a season ago. Where does he fit into this offense, Greg?
Well, he's going to have to do a little bit more, but really it's going to come down to his offensive line, whether or not they can allow him to spring free and get into the secondary. As you can see, he's tough to bring down. He's a big body. He's developed from year one to year two. Like Jabari mentioned, you can really advance physically. The great thing is he's not going to have to carry the load. Alvin Kamara comes in, transfer from the junior college, originally signed at Alabama. A little quicker, a little lighter, does a great job coming out of the backfield and being effective in the receiving game as well. So I love the fact that they now have a 1-2 punch, but I do have some worries about that offensive line that's already lost two guys to season-ending injuries.
Yeah, it's going to be tough for them. I think that Jalen Hurd to take that next step. We saw he runs a little high. He's a big guy. He got to put those shoulder pads down so he can last the whole year.
Well, the top five receivers return for Tennessee, so that's kind of good news. They have experience where that is concerned, Greg. Do you see that unit taking a step forward?
Outside of Texas A&M, I think Tennessee has the deepest core of wide receivers with Marquez North, big body receiver who's just scratching the surface as to what he can be. A little hobbled in fall camp with an injury, but he should be back and be very impressive. And a Pig Howard, outstanding out of the slot. Von Pearson, you name it, they are deep enough to go with anyone in the SEC. It's just whether or not they can spring free against some of the improving secondaries they're going to see in the SEC.
Yeah, you've named all their names. I honestly like Marquez North. He reminds me of Marcus Colston, you know, the guy that can go up in the red zone, get the ball. Josh Malone reminds me of a Robert Meacham. You remember that name? This guy has speed, can go up and really make plays on the ball. But my favorite receiver is Pig Howard. I love this guy. He has a compact body. But the way that they use him in a screen game out in the bubbles, he takes that ball. He could take a 5-yard pass and take it to the end zone. I love that guy.
Well, Pig Howard led the team last season in receptions and yards. So maybe another big year for Pig Howard moving forward. Well, we just started breaking down the offense of Tennessee. Plenty more to cover. Volunteers, they have high expectations. Fans hope Tennessee challenges for the East. And you'll find out how coaches motivate their players when we go SEC inside the Tennessee program. And Butch Jones, he's on the sidelines. He's getting his team ready, and he's brought in two back-to-back top five recruiting classes.
We're just in the infant stages of our program. It's one thing to build a team. It's another to build a...
Tennessee may have improved by two in the win column, but Butch Jones, well, his squad significantly improved on the field. Let's go next level. The Volunteers improved their offensive and defensive efficiencies by at least 3 points on both sides of the ball in 2014. And at SEC Media Days, Butch Jones told me that it's time for his team to prepare for the next level.
Entering your third season at Tennessee, and you're coming off a huge bowl win and a 7-6 season, what have you ultimately learned since you started your time in Knoxville?
Our football team, our football program has learned how to win. And that's the most difficult thing in all of sport. And it's a byproduct of being 4-1 at the end of the season, obviously a great, great bowl win. But our players have put a lot of hard work and effort into it, but it's learning how to win now. We just don't hope to win, we expect to win.
How do you develop that in a team? Because it seems like it's something so intangible, but you talk about it all the time.
It's the most challenging thing in all of sport, like I said. And you have to have a breakthrough moment. You have to have a breakthrough win where maybe you had so much adversity that they didn't expect to win, and you find a way to persevere and find a way to win. And for us, you know, all roads lead us to that South Carolina game on the road. It was the first road victory in a number of years, and we had so many adversities and things that went our way, and a lot that we did ourselves to ourselves. But we found a way to get the game into overtime and then make big-time plays to win the football game.
It's coming down to the wire.
Second and goal, 15 seconds left. Pressure coming. Dobbs, Mitchell, touchdown, Tennessee! Butch Jones has his first SEC win of the season. Heartfelt victory for the Volunteers, scrambling their way back for the win.
Let's talk about Josh Dobbs, because he did something extraordinary, going from basically third string to being one of the best quarterbacks in the SEC. As you get to reflect on the entire season, what do you remember about his entire journey through 2014?
Resiliency. Perseverance, always staying locked in and always waiting for that moment. We always talk to our quarterbacks. It doesn't matter if you're the second string guy or third string guy. You're either one snap away or two snaps away. And to his credit, he had himself ready for when he had that opportunity. He made the most of it.
Do you think if you could go back, you would have started him sooner, or there was still something that he was working on in practices to get him to that moment?
No, I think that really to be able to bring him along slowly really helped him at the end of the day. He had some things from a fundamental standpoint that he had to get corrected, and to his credit, he worked exceptionally hard. But I think to be able to learn from a Justin Worley and how you prepare an older player on your football team, so I really think the way it was handled really helped him have success down the road.
One thing you've had success with is recruiting. Top five recruiting classes. You're one of only three schools that can claim that over the last two seasons. If you were giving a recruiting pitch, you've got a family right in front of you, just pretend like I'm the family. What is your tag, your hook, line, and sinker that helps you pull in such great recruits?
Well, first of all, it's all about people. People make a place, and we're all about family. And we have tremendous people in place. And where would you else want to go to school than the University of Tennessee? And everything in life is about timing, being at the right place at the right time, and being on the forefront of things. And we really firmly believe that Tennessee is the right place at the right time. Now, will you sign on the dotted line, please?
I'm here. I'm ready for you now, Coach. One of the first that you had to go through over the spring is getting a brand new coordinator for the first time at Tennessee. You had to deal with that. And you bring on Mike DeBoard, who is a longtime friend of yours. Just walk me through how you came to the decision that he was the guy that was going to help your offense this year.
Well, we had a profile. It's just like in recruiting, we have a recruiting profile. We had a profile that we were looking for in a coordinator, somebody that I trusted, somebody that had been, that called plays at a high level, that had won, somebody that I could trust. And when you look at Mike DeBoard, all roads led to him. He's provided so much stability, new energy, new enthusiasm. Our players have gravitated towards him, but I also needed somebody to command the room, somebody to be able to be the head coach of the offense, command that room, but also command a staff as well, because we've been together for a long period of time as a staff. So it had to be a great fit. Everything is about a fit within our football family, and Mike DeBoard was the perfect fit.
Let's talk about managing expectations, because now they're there in Rocky Top. I mean, you can talk to any media member, and you're kind of trendy pick right now in the East. Everyone expects great things from your team. How do you manage that expectation but continue to do what got you there?
Well, the expectations will always be high at Tennessee, but the internal expectations will always be the highest, and you have to embrace them. This is why these individuals chose to come to the University of Tennessee. We talked about being at the right place at the right time and building something special and leaving your legacy. We're just in the infant stages of our program. It's one thing to build a team, it's another to build a football program. That's what we're building. But that's what you want. You have to embrace them, but you can never forget who you are. We are in control of our work ethic, our fundamentals, our details, our excellence, our character, our decision-making process. Those are the things that we need to focus on. If we do that, we'll be okay.
Well, Tennessee has certainly been okay under the watchful eye of Butch Jones, joined again by Jabari Greer and Greg McElroy. And we'll start with you, Jabari, because you've seen Tennessee when it was high, when you guys are playing in the SEC championship, and you've seen the low when Butch Jones took over. So how would you describe what he's been able to do in just two seasons in Knoxville with Tennessee?
I think the biggest thing that he's been able to do is establish culture in Tennessee, something that unfortunately didn't have the Tennessee didn't have over the last two coaches. So I think that what he's doing brick by brick, engaging the constituency, so to say, with the fans and students, and even reaching out to former players. I remember last year, two years ago, I'm getting ready for the training camp, and I get a call from Butch Jones telling me to come back when I get an opportunity to really let these young men know that there's an opportunity for them working hard, engaging each other and becoming a family. He is putting something, he is laying down a foundation for a successful program at Tennessee. I'm proud of him, and I want to see what he does. I want to see the production.
I like from a player's perspective, mm-hmm. and as a young man, he has sayings that we look at that resonate with us. Yeah. People make places, brick by brick, third down, for all these things that as young players you can rally around, and they stick with you. They might come across as cliches, they might be used as coach speak or whatever it may be, but as a player, I remember those things. So when I'm trying to apply them to my lifestyle, I can resonate because of how he uses them and how often he uses them. I think he's doing a great job.
Yeah, from 5'7" to 7'6", and also on the recruiting trail, the talent he's been able to bring in, how has he been able to demand manufacture that so quickly?
Well, I think people want to come to Tennessee. You know, it's not something that you have a problem getting talent, but the way that they use talent, when Tennessee comes into your door, they let you know that if you can play, you will play early. And that's something that these young men want to do when they get the opportunity. They want to go to an organization in which they play early, and that's what Tennessee's been able to do.
Well, two back-to-back top five recruiting classes for Butch Jones, and we know that there's plenty of young talent. One of those includes Khalil McKenzie. He is the top signee for Butch Jones this season. You see him just kind of running over an offensive lineman there. I mean, he looks pretty good for a youngin', guys.
Pretty good, yeah. I mean, this is a dominant performance. I love the leverage he gets. I'm not going to get too carried away by what we're looking at right now. I love the
drills. Don't get you excited.
Don't get me wrong. One-on-one, I love it. But, you know, that center right there who's on an island will, in fact, have two guards on the outside. And, you know, the quarterback, if he's smart enough, can use a little bit of cadence and go on two maybe, so it won't get that kind of jump.
Jabari talked about culture that we have seen Butch Jones bring, and one of those things is the black stripe that's removed from newcomers' helmets once they have proved that they deserve it. Kyle Phillips tweeting out on August 10th, He was the second freshman to actually have his stripe removed, and you can see how exciting it is for this entire group. And the newcomers are what Butch Jones is having to build his entire team on. So who do you see, Greg, making an impact this season?
I'm going with Khalil McKenzie and the defensive tackle. I think he's going to do an outstanding job. He's a big body. I'm not sure he's a really complete player yet. I want to see him rush the passer and not be just a first and second down defensive tackle. I think he can develop into that. It's just going to take time for him to hone in his craft, get comfortable with the defensive scheme, and understand that he's not always going to be a playmaker. He's more of a space eater. Knowing his role within the defense, I think, is going to be imperative if they want to continue to improve at the defensive tackle position.
I agree with that. I believe McKenzie has a great opportunity. You know, I would like to see what he does when they play Florida and they have those big-time SEC games. You know, playing in Neyland Stadium can be a daunting task for anybody when you play in front of 106,000 to 108,000 people a game. So, you know, how do you adjust to the lights? When it's time to play, do you rise up or do you fold? So I think that he might be somebody I look forward to watching.
Something that's going to help the youngins adjust is having some veterans there. And they've got Derek Barnett, they've got Kurt Majette, and they combined for 21 sacks a season ago. So where do they go from here?
Well, I think they're only going to get better. I think Derek Barnett's scratching the surface of what he can be, and Kurt Majette on the other side bookending that defensive line. It's a tenacious force, and when you look at the way the SEC East has unfolded the last couple years, Missouri has been the winner of the division in consecutive seasons. What did Missouri have that most other schools in the East did not? Two defensive ends that can really apply pressure to the quarterback. In 2013, it was Coney Ealy and Michael Sam. Last year, Shane Ray, Marcus Golden. This year, I think Tennessee has the best defensive end combination in Derek Barnett and Kurt Majette.
Yeah, these guys reminded me of some guys that I played with, Will Smith and Charles Grant. They made my job a lot easier. As a corner, when you have two guys that can get upfield like Majette and Barnett, you know, I mean, it's an interception waiting to happen. These guys are going to put a lot of pressure on the quarterback.
All right, the Tennessee defense looking to continue to improve. Seven of their top eight defensive linemen return for the 2015 season.
You know what? Circle it up. Let's go. Give me Mosley and McKenzie. Mosley and McKenzie. First one of the year.
All right. Well, there are the drills that are taking place on Rocky Top. We'll take you inside the Tennessee.
Dobbs is going to run it on fourth and three. Dobbs breaks to the outside. Touchdown, Tennessee.
Tennessee, the dark horse to win the East. And now we go inside the program, the brand new show, SEC Inside.
All right, good morning, men. Two goals for the day. Number one, competing. Second one, 1% better. It's good stuff. All right, open it up, page 147, core values. Core values are a belief system. They're your identity. They're what we stand for. You know, you notice we don't have a mission statement. We have a group identity. We have core values. We have a culture. A culture is more important than a mission statement. Remember, you can have a mission statement, but if you don't have people on a mission with you, you're in trouble. Remember what we talked about, 1% better. So I need you to grind it. This is where your toughness is born right now. Let's have a great day. We need to get a little energy going today. Summer school's over with. It's football time. You gotta love this. Have a little bit of energy to you. No vampires. Rip, rip, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Very nice. You never know when you're being evaluated.
You gotta be much faster so you can explode. Right now, you're kind of doing this.
Burst! There you go! Drive it! Come on! There you go. That's one good rep. You know what? Circle it up. Let's go. Give me Mosley and McKenzie. Mosley and McKenzie. First one of the year. All right, that We have not seen that in Circle of Life since we've been here. That right there was refreshing. Culture. Perfect every time. Perfect every time. It's better, Nate. Fundamentals and details.
Get up. Good job. Accelerate on contact, guys. Break off tackle. Bam. Get up. Good.
That's it.
Great details. Keep working, man. Keep working. Get it out there.
Good job, Josh.
Get me out of my break. Give me a first move at the top. First. There you go. Come back. Put it away. Tight. Good tight turn, Josh. Nice job. Feet. Effort. Football endurance.
To go, my friend.
Get it out. Stay up. Sprint up. Good job. There's four phases to football. There's offense, defense, special teams, and football life. All right? I want you to think about this. The transition from high school to college, it's not the speed of the game. It's the speed of life. Immature teams can't handle the speed of life. All of a sudden, the clutter, the distraction, the parties. That affects more people than offense, defense, or special teams. The life of football. When it becomes faster than you, that's when you struggle and you get out of control. So as we go through the phases, make sure you understand that is life. That's football life.
That's your sneak peek at SEC Inside Tennessee. You can watch the brand new show September 9th, starting out with Vanderbilt and Florida. Now it's our favorite time of the show because Jabari and Greg get to choose how many wins and losses Tennessee is going to have this season. We've already picked the gimmies, the games you guys agree on, and at bare minimum, Tennessee is going to have 5 wins, guys. Let's start with Oklahoma, though.
We can't skip over Bowling Green, can we? Butch Jones would be upset. All right, Oklahoma, I think the game's in Neyland Stadium. Tennessee has enough experience and enthusiasm to protect the home field. Baker Mayfield, new starting quarterback for Oklahoma, new offensive coordinator for Oklahoma. The continuity defensively for Tennessee is what gives them the W.
Well, I disagree right there, and I might get some calls from the Vol Nation, but the thing is that Oklahoma is just stacked. Their receiver position is one of the deepest in the NCAA. They have a dark horse Heisman Trophy candidate in Samaje Perine, so I think they're going to come in, and they beat the Volunteers last year. I think they're going to come in with the L.
I break the tie. I'm giving them the win.
I'll take that.
I hope
okay. All right, at Florida, I think the streak comes to an end. Florida's offensive line right now has a lot of inexperience. Had 4 guys drafted off of it last year. I think Tennessee goes in, dominates the line of scrimmage, and gets a much-needed win against their arch-rival, the Gators.
Yeah, listen, Maria, everything this guy's saying is dead on.
Okay.
He's a smart man.
Done deal.
Florida with the
W. Yes.
Tennessee with the win.
This will be an interesting game, Arkansas. Arkansas can control the line of scrimmage. Tennessee's defensive line solid. Linebacker core, secondary. I think the Tennessee gets it done. Only because of the home field. If this game is in Fayetteville, I'm taking the Hogs. But the home field gives the advantage to the Volunteers.
Yeah, I think Arkansas really has a tough time on their hands with the injury of Jonathan Williams. It's going to be tough them coming in and beating Tennessee. Tennessee wins this one.
So this is the game everyone's going to be focused on, because this could decide the SEC East. Who do you have winning the Georgia-Tennessee game?
I think Georgia's just deep on the offensive line. I think they do a great job with their defensive scheme. Their linebackers are off the charts good. Their secondary is steadily improving. And they have a rock-solid running game, so I'm going with the Georgia Bulldogs. I think it's their year in the SEC.
No.
What?
No, I'm going with Tennessee. You know, Georgia has great outside pressure, but I think Mike DeBoer is going to do something to neutralize that, using Josh Dobbs to step up in the pocket and then run out. So I think that he's going to win.
Don't even finish my argument.
At Alabama, I think that's a tough game. If it's in Knoxville, I think they have a better chance. But I got to go with the Tide in Bryant Denny protecting the home field.
Yeah, I have to go with Alabama as well. Tennessee, it's going to be tough to win at Bryant Denny Stadium.
South Carolina, Missouri, guys, who you got?
I'm taking Tennessee in both games. I think they're better than South Carolina. Yeah. I think this is the year that Missouri comes back down to earth and Tennessee finishes in sole second in the SEC East.
All right, 10-2, you got it. So you don't have Tennessee winning the East for the first time since 07. Those are your predictions for the Volunteers.